Hi everybody, Dr. A, continuing our toxicology basics on drugs of abuse testing, and now we're going to look at testing procedures. Alright, so drug testing is a two-step process, and it consists of an initial screening test and then confirmatory testing for any positive results. Confirmatory testing may not be done in certain clinical situations, but could be requested by the physician later as a follow-up. So again, a typical ER visit, patient's unconscious, think they might have been taking some drugs. There's usually a panel that can be ordered, and it would be done as a screening test. And if then that confirms the suspicions and there's no need for confirmation, then often it's not done. Then it could be like later if the patient is admitted, the admitting physician might want to, you know, get more specific testing, but oftentimes the screening is enough for medical. And for certain legal tests and stuff, they may go straight to the confirmation testing. So you have to know that false positive and false negative results can occur at the screening stage. So those screening tests do have things that can cause cross-reactivity and cause false negatives or false positives. So you know, one would need to really consider the whole clinical picture and everything, and make sure that they don't take action just on preliminary drug screens. That could be a problem, especially trying to take legal action on and just an initial drug screen. So if there's going to be any kind of legal ramifications, confirmation tests is really, really needed. So labs that performed drug abuse testing used commercially available assays that have been developed and optimized to screen for major and most common drugs of abuse. So the screen, when used in this context, means a preliminary result. And so it's presumably positive for opiates or presumably positive for benzodiazepines or something like that. So a drug screen can be composed of any number of assays for different drugs and drug classes. So some of the examples of the typical drugs that are included in these drug screens are screening for amphetamines, and then sometimes specifically methamphetamines, okay, barbiturates, benzodiazepines, cannabinoids, cocaine, opiates, and PCP. So those are pretty typical of your initial drug screens. So then the patient results are compared with a predetermined cutoff value for each drug or drug class. The analyzer does that, and a result below the value is reported out as none detected, sometimes reported out as negative. And it doesn't mean that the drug wasn't actually there or never taken. It just means that it was below detectable levels, so not enough to trigger a positive. Okay, and then patient results that are above the cutoff value, then they're reported at as positive or detected. And again, especially if there's legal ramification, these need to be confirmed with a more specific and sensitive test, which is usually done with a different analytical technique, more precise one. But again, if it's a medical screen and there's no legal ramification, a lot of times the screening is enough, especially if it fits with the clinical picture. So then, but let's say there is legal ramification and something triggered a positive on initial screen test, and then we need to order confirmation testing. Usually the gold standard of confirmation testing is going to be gas chromatography and mass spectrometry. So GCMS testing is it. And just to let you know, GCMS testing is usually done in reference labs. Your average lab in your hospital or your clinic is not going to have GCMS testing capacity. So the majority of confirmatory drug testing are done by local or regional reference laboratories because, again, the GCMS testing is more time-consuming, is costly, and requires technical expertise to perform it. So specimens that yield positive results are often frozen for a year or longer if requested by the patient or client, or if the results are contested by a court. So you should be able to get access to that specimen again and retest it if needed. So types of specimens or drug matrices to test. So the most frequently tested sample is urine, very easily obtained. But other specimens can be obtained, such as hair, saliva, sweat, and blood. But the results are not interchangeable with the urine drug screen results, and the methodologies are not interchangeable either. I've known, for example, some nursing programs, instead of doing the urine drug screens, they do the hair because it captures, I think, a longer span of time. So the drug compounds that I found in these other matrices are primarily the parent, the original drug, not the metabolites, and they do reflect a different window or time period of drug use. And like I said, for hair, for sure, it's going to be longer, a longer time period. And so that, for example, screening using hair for either pre-employment or for admission into like a health professional program, what they're trying to do is to find habitual drug users and, you know, unfortunately usually deny them entry into the program because that can be a problem with practicing the profession. So urine drug screens usually reflect drug use over the last 2 or 3 days for amphetamines, cocaines, and opiates. An exception is going to be marijuana. The cannabinoids can be detectable for several weeks. So hair testing using the root end of the hair will reflect drug use within the last 2 to 3 months, but not drug use occurring 1 to 7 days prior to the test. So saliva samples will show which drugs have been used within the last 24 hours. And then sweat collected by wearing a patch can demonstrate evidence of drug use for up to 7 days. However, again, only a limited number of labs are able to do sweat testing. So urine and probably then hair would be the two most used types of samples that we can do drug testing on for, you know, the various reasons we've already outlined. So hair samples are used as an alternative to urine testing for pre-employment and drug screening and also pre-admission into professional programs. Sweat testing can be done as court-ordered monitoring tool for those who have been convicted of drug use and they are incarcerated or in the legal system. Saliva samples are often used by the insurance industry to test insurance applicants for cocaine use, and blood is the most frequently used sample for alcohol testing and do blood alcohol levels. And that would be maybe to confirm a breathalyzer test, right? They didn't know the breath alcohol, but we want to confirm it. So you can do blood alcohol testing for that. And there you go. That wraps up our samples and testing for drugs of abuse. Thank you.